We are live, and our guest is Kate Gladstone.
Sentences that include every letter in the alphabet.
Yes, I certainly did, and I use a lot of those who practice on the site. It's not my name that I coined. It's a name that's been around for a while, which is called Pangram. P as in potato, A, N as in November, G-R-A, M as in month. Elamites, because I was trying to get down to work on this, and there was actually a list of some of the words that existed in the Elamite language, which is not really
cuneiform. Got started several thousand years ago when small clay tokens let you track your income and outgo. You stamped them onto your receipt, a bigger ball of clay. Tucked them inside and sealed it up and stashed the thing away.
And now, Kate Gladstone.
Hello. Good to see
you. Hi, Kate. It's wonderful to see you.
Thank you. Now, you'll have noticed that tonight I'm wearing a little different hat, and you're wondering, why is she wearing a fake plastic pirate hat with chopsticks in it? Well, I thought I'd see if the audience wanted me to dress up with funny hats now and again. And why this one? Because tonight we'll be talking about an 18th century fellow, there hence the hat style, who made a career out of pretending to be an Asian, picking an actual Asian country that neither he nor others had ever been to, and basically making out that he was royalty from there, that he was traveling the world, that he was hoping to raise money to bring, you know, the Asians of this far-off land to Christianity. And since he'd never been there, he basically bloody well made up his own fake Asian culture, fake Asian language, and of course, fake Asian writing system. Well, we all make up interesting things from time to time, but this fellow actually fooled Oxford University. And only then, at the very last moment, when he realized he got cut out, he decided to fess up and became a celebrity all over again. Now, I just want to plug in my little charger. I've been having some power issues. So if you will excuse me, I'm trying to make this thing work for the duration of our broadcast. I probably won't be writing anything.
Oh dear, you seem to have lost Kate.
No, goodness, great. Thank goodness, no.
I'm sorry. I don't know what happened.
Neither do I. I've had some odd issues. Sometimes there's a little power surge, and I think it, like, you know, screws up the electronics. But in any case, today we will be learning the amazing story of a fellow known to history as George Psalmanazar, which was not his real name, because even when he fessed up about who he was and what he did, he never told us his actual name.
Do you think he was naming himself after the Psalms or something like that?
No, actually, because when he fessed up, he did explain that he had picked his name. It was from a biblical source, but it was basically from a Catholic edition of the Bible. He had grown up Catholic, and in the Bible, the name of the Assyrian king Shalmaneser is transcribed in a very Latinate way as Psalmanazar, and he apparently stuck a P in the front just to look it more alien, so to speak. He did claim in his fake history of the country he claimed to be from, Formosa, now known as Taiwan, he did claim that the name was an old one in his country and that it had been the name of a great prophetic leader who had founded their civilization. Well, you can make up anything you want, and I will say he had a terrific imagination. He should have gone in for writing fiction because his book is as detailed, as fascinating as Lord of the Rings, even though it doesn't really have a plot. He's just, it's a fake travelogue that, that literally fooled everybody who could read and read travelogues or was interested in foreign countries or languages or academics. And of course, what concerns us was he made up a fake writing system. One of the worst reasons in the world to make up your own language and writing system. I believe there are good reasons, but he had a bad reason, which was to dupe people into making him a celebrity and giving him money. And he was at this for literally decades until he realized, uh-oh, people are finding out too much about actual Formosa. They're going to go there and they're going to be auntie. Actually, people had been there before, but when they told the truth, they were disbelieved for reasons we will get into. So let's go on with the show.
Okay, the slideshow.
Yes.
Okay, not that one. This one.
Yeah. So all right. He claimed to be, you know, a member of, you know, the Taiwanese nobility, you know, very high nobility. And he was, and he would basically wander around Europe, England, and other places, basically claiming, you know, very much in the vein of people nowadays who sit around doing email and claiming to be Nigerian princes who need money to fund their various enterprises, and people send them this money. Well, back then, people thought everything Asian was cool, and everything, much like many people today, and everything Asian was very unknown. You could literally say anything you liked. Remember that at about the same time, in another work of fiction that pretended to be fact, but as a fictional gimmick that really, you know, people eventually knew it was fiction. You know, Jonathan Swift, when he wrote Gulliver's Travels and he made up all these countries to go to, at one point, when he was in the country of Laputa, he made up that he got to be on a side trip to Japan. And he actually did make up fake Japanese this and that, although he did use occasional bits of actual Japanese. For instance, Gulliver, if you read enough of that particular chapter of Gulliver's Travels, you'll find that Gulliver, he was a little better than this fake we're talking about tonight, because Jonathan Swift claimed that his hero had, on his side trip to Japan, got to visit a city in Japan called Nagasaki, which, as you know, is the way that Nagasaki usually gets pronounced in Japanese. So in a satirical work of fiction, you know, Jonathan Swift was more honest than our fellow that we're talking about by at least the worth of one place name. Anyway, why don't you go on? We'll learn a little about this fellow, what we know about him. Well, he was born, we are not sure exactly when, he was a little cagey. It may have been 1679 or 1684, anywhere in between. We know, or at least he said so when he fessed up about his life after almost getting caught out, that he was born somewhere in southern France. He was very, very poor, and he was looking, you know, for a way to make some money. Now, his first venture in life, before he hit on the Taiwanese prince business, was he knew that there were a lot of Catholic pilgrims from all sorts, all corners of the world, you know, walking around southern France, visiting the pilgrimage sites of the various saints. And he decided that he would run off and pretend to be an Irish pilgrim. Well, he was caught out by either actual Irishmen or people at least had encountered actual Irishmen who basically knew that he was making this up. At a later period in life, he pretended for a while to be a Japanese heathen, quote unquote, who had somehow stowed away and ended up in England. And, you know, but people knew a little about Japan, and some of them might have been more on to him than he liked. We figured, you know, why pretend to be from a place that people are starting to get a little more trade with? Japan was starting to get a little more visited, when he could be from somewhere really exotic. Well, no one had been, as far as he knew, very few people had been to Taiwan, or as it was then called in the West, Formosa, and those who had been were not likely to be believed. Now, why weren't they likely to be believed? Because most of the Europeans who had ever been to And for now, I'll call it Taiwan when I'm talking about the real country, and I'll call it Formosa when I'm talking about his fantasy. Even though this is very anachronistic, we have to keep them separate. Most of the people who'd been in Taiwan in the late 17th and early 18th century were Jesuit missionaries, and Jesuits were very suspected of all kinds of political wheeling dealings and all kinds of corruption. They were even suspected by many of their fellow Catholics, not to mention the many Protestant nations certainly suspected them. So, you know,
weren't the Spanish colonizing Formosa?
And no one really liked the Spanish either, at least not in England, where George, we'll call him George, had ended up. Yeah, okay. In other words, there were the Spanish there, but, you know, there were certainly the Jesuits. You know, they say that, you know, religion follows the flag. You know, if you conquer something, you're going to be bringing your clerics, you know. That's just common sense. It's, face it, it's what invaders do, you know. And, you know that, in other words, the credibility of anything you heard from someone who wrote a scholarly paper, and many of these Jesuits were very scholarly people, had a great love for the language and culture they were studying, the actual one. They, you know, if someone wrote this, and let's say you're sitting in London, or, you know, or someplace, you know, or Hanover or someplace, you're sitting someplace in Europe and reading something that was written by Father so-and-so reporting on, you know, a strange country that he was in, where he is being a missionary, Catholic missionary. You're not really going to believe this if you are not a Catholic and perhaps a Catholic missionary yourself. You'll say, oh, we know those people. They're all full of the tricks. You know, this is probably some plot. They're, you know, doing some fake news. They're doing some disinformation, as we would say. So if you're going to pick a country to claim to be from, not only pick one that nobody ever went to, but pick one that if people have heard a little bit about it, they're not inclined to believe it. To take a modern analogy, how, you know, you or I or many people today might not feel very credible, might not feel a great deal of credibility if, let's say, you had a report that an astronaut had been to Mars, but the report, you know, came from the space agency of Afghanistan or Iran or somewhere else, or somewhere else similarly far off and unknown to us, and sort of we don't like them, you know? For whatever reason, we may not like them. So he basically went around, raising money to, you know, that he was supposedly eventually going to use to go and Christianize the poor, benighted people of Formosa. These people were very cultured, but gosh, you know, they need Christianity, you know. How else are you going to appeal to people in the 17th or 18th century except by saying, you know, come over and, you know, convert us? At one point, in fact, he actually had a missionary on his side, a missionary who claimed to be the man who had converted this Formosan prince to Christianity and had led him to adopt the name George in front of his Formosan name. Now, we don't know to this day if that particular missionary, Mr. Ellis, was in on the gag and knew he was aiding and abetting a fake, or really thought that he had encountered a poor, you know, a rich wandering, you know, foreigner and had, you know, brought him to see the light. He could have fooled a cleric as easily as he fooled anyone else. What concerns us, since this is an episode, since this is a series about unusual, you know, about writing systems and the cultures they belong to, is that this fellow, you know, wrote a book in which he created an entire and completely made up Formosan language, alphabet, culture. The book purported to be a history of Formosa, giving, you know, all the details about its culture, its history, past and present. In other words, it purported to be, you know, a scholarly sort of travel guide, the sort of thing that any explorer would write from another, who was visiting another country or who had come from another country. Well, it became an international celebrity coming from some exotic Asian place, you know. Much as someone might be a celebrity, suppose you met someone who came from, you know, today would have to be another planet. Suppose someone said, well, there are people on Mars and I'm one of them, and here's how I got to Earth, and here is, you know, a whole history of Mars. People would believe it. Maybe not as easily now as then, but they had no way to check. You know, it's not like they're going to go on the internet and go and call up Google Earth and, you know, see what's actually there. So
now, let me ask you this, Kate.
Yes.
There's this picture here on the slide.
That's presumably him. That's him.
Yes. Based on what?
It's based on, apparently, it's basically an engraving from the time. Remember, he was famous. People invited him to their parties and they, you know, and he, and this particular picture, though, was from the frontispiece to his book. I see his book. He had more than one. His first book was the one with the fake. I'll tell you about the other ones later, you know, the ones after he sort
but,
of.
But I mean, this kind of looks like a Westerner.
It does. And he was. He was born in southern France. But remember, who in Europe in 1700 some odd had any idea what an Asian looked like? You would not necessarily know, even if you knew that they tended to be yellowish or brownish and you heard something about an unusual eye shape, you might assume that the Formosans are different. There are different countries out there, obviously, just as there are in Europe or anywhere. In other words, he didn't have to look like anything special. He didn't, no one had, for instance, ever heard, you know, an East Asian language, so he didn't have to do some kind of fake Asian accent as people might today if they were tempted to put on some kind of Asian act. He didn't have to dye his hair. He didn't certainly didn't have to go and, you know, do anything about how he looked because all he had to do was to say that, you know, whatever people might look like in other countries, his people had been in this far off land from time immemorial. That's all he had to do.
Yeah, I think the thing that is most prominently obviously not local is his nose, you know. I mean,
definitely, you know, you would have to go very far before you found an actual East Asian who looked anything like that in terms of facial features. Now, it's obvious from what he made up that he was able to get away with literally anything, as you will see, for literally long enough that at one point he literally, you know, Oxford University at one point actually offered him to chair a department of Formosan studies that they wanted to found. And that's when he turned it down. He figured, you know, this can't go on, you know. But I'll talk about that when the time comes. But, you know, when Oxford University, you know, let's just say that even in, you know, even in the 18th century, they would have been capable, if not of doing a background check, if they had gone far enough, you know, if they had actually, you know, chartered a ship and put him on it and put people on it to go over there, it would have blown it up, you know. Let's just say there's a term Conlang, which is constructed languages, but I would have to say that this con man gave Conlang a whole new meaning. Now, perhaps we might go on and look at, I see I have a typo there. Never mind, we can always fix it if I go over publication. Here are some of his fun, fictitious, and very fake facts on his fake Formosa. And I did give some links, which are in the description, and you can read his book. You know, and you can see, well, for one thing, he claimed that all upper-class Formosan lived in holes in the ground. And he has drawings, you know, of these underground dwellings, very neat and very civilized.
Are they like hobbit holes?
Well, they're more like, imagine 18th century British houses holes underground. In other words, they're a little more elegant. He makes out that this is a very elegant and rich and cultured people. But they live underground and hardly ever come out. That is actually one thing he said when some people questioned why he was so pale, as they had heard that Asians tended to run a little darker than Europeans. And he said, oh, well, I'm upper class and I grew up in a hole in the ground. You know, hardly ever saw the sun because the upper classes only come out when they have to, which was, of course, entirely credible to Europeans of the period, because that was one of the cultures that make a great big deal about upper class people not really having to be out in the sun. And therefore, you know, even to this day in many civilizations.
Yeah, no,
you know,
I mean, that's true in the Asian culture, you know.
Yes, well, that is
all the
true.
Women with parasols and everything.
Yeah, and his pictures actually, when he draws pictures, he does show the women having these sort of vaguely Asian fashions. It's been speculated that he read a bit about different cultures and had picked some of the cooler and slash or more possibly believable bits. In other words, if he had a picture of a woman with a parasol and a veil and a long silken robe and said, you know, this is how a maiden dresses in Formosa, they'd believe it because they might have heard something about, oh yeah, overseas they have silk and they have long robes. But he claimed that, in fact, that the women wore beautiful gowns and veils, and he draws different styles that would be worn by a maiden, a widow, a married woman, you know, a loose woman, and so on, you know. But then he claims that male attire consisted solely of a metal jockstrap. As he says, it's a plate to cover the male organ. He has some praise, but we would call it a metal jockstrap that was chained on. It goes into how there are different styles and materials, based on on how wealthy you are. It could be iron, it could be silver, it could be gold. I'm really not sure whether he thought about the sheer discomfort of this, but he probably knew his audience, and he knew that people then, as sometimes now, would go ooh and ah over pictures of ooh the semi-naked heathens in far corners of the world, and there was a certain he might have figured, oh yeah, give them an aesthetic appeal, to the people like to think about beautiful garments, will write up, about the women who having all this beautiful clothing, and for the people whose interests are sort of the other extreme and they're sort of into looking at the human form, we could say, well, the men really show themselves off. And of course, he claimed to say, well, of course, that these people were civilized and wealthy and rich and influential in this far off country. But of course, he claimed that they were very, very unlike his dear hosts out in the West. His claim was that each year there was a ceremony at the New Year where their high priest sacrificed 180,000 baby boys. But fortunately, not to worry, because he became a Christian, and that's why his first name is George. Okay, so this is as if this was
ridiculous. Okay, well, let me ask you this, Kate. If they could afford to sacrifice 180,000 baby boys, what was the population of Formosa?
I think he says things like, he's got it up in the several millions. But I think he was basic. I forget the exact figure, but I think he was counting on his audience not to do the math. But he talks about how it's a very fertile island and very populous and very full of people. It's possible that he's saying he can afford to do this. And interestingly, that particular bit about the baby boy human sacrifices was actually picked up in an actual satirical work by Jonathan Swift. You have probably read his Jonathan Swift satirical essay, A Modest Proposal, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For those who aren't familiar, this is the one where Jonathan Swift pretends to have a solution to the famine problem that existed in Ireland and to Ireland's very bad economy at the time. And his made-up solution was that, basically they should raise babies like farm animals and kill them and eat them. And at one point when he claims this should actually work, he claims, not only does he claim that he had met a Native American who said that his tribe, ate little children, which I'm not going to get into. I think it was like he made up, but he claims, and of course, we've all read the book of the famous Psalmanazar, and, they go and they kill lots of babies and eat them, and yet they're a populous and thriving country, So if it's good enough for them, it's good enough for us. I'm obviously paraphrasing here. But, those who are interested, many people have read Modest Proposal and have just glossed over this through not knowing who Psalmanazar was. I mean, he was famous in his day. Not knowing who he was would have been like not knowing who, Beyonce was today, or not knowing.
So when Jonathan Swift wrote his Modest Proposal, did he already know that?
He may have known. We're not sure. We are not sure. He didn't say anything one way or another. However, we do know that one of the people he fooled for many years was Samuel Johnson, who thought Psalmanazar was amazing when Psalmanazar was running around being a Formosan prince, and who thought Psalmanazar was even more amazing when he finally fessed up and spent the rest of his life writing quite different sorts of material. Although he did die in poverty, he was famous for a while. But anyway, that remains to be seen. We probably want to, my interest is, one, he pulled this off. Number two, he should have been a fiction writer, because what he writes, even though he doesn't have a plot because he's just writing a fake history and travel log, is very, very cinematic. You read this and you can think of someone making a movie that would happen in this exotic land. In fact, for any of you science fiction people out there who like to write alternate history and imagined universes, if you want to imagine a world history in which his book would have been sober fact, in which the history of East Asia would have been very different, go to it. His book is certainly in the public domain. And it's actually fun enough that when I was reading it, I was saying, you know, my God, you know, this stuff is interesting enough that I wish it would be real, except for the killing babies part, of course. You know, it would be amazing if this was real. And since it can't be real and shouldn't have because of killing all those babies, you know, this should be, it would be an amazing background for a fantasy movie. You know, I mean, I can see Hollywood, you know, going on to every detail of, you know, whatever buff male actors they would pick out or whatever, you know, beautiful women might be hiding behind those veils and parasols and hats and so on, you know. Anyway.
Well, I mean, they couldn't call it Formosa because.
No, but they could call it something else. They could say, they could make up a fake name like the land of Psalmanazar. You know, that's alleged, you know, the name problem is actually alleged to be one of the reasons that they never finished filming the Narnia series of films, if you're familiar with that, if you like fantasy. Ever watched that series?
Yeah, well, sure. You know, I read it.
I read it and I loved it and still love it. And I watched the movies when they came out, but of course they stopped just sort of doing my favorite book in the series, which was The Silver Chair. And of course I knew why. That book, when they were filming it, it was right after Trump was elected. And if you remember, one of the characters, one of the, you know, politicians who is one of the advisors to the prince is a rather short, rather not quite so quick on the uptake fellow. He's a dwarf and he's not really, really friendly dwarf. He's sort of mean and crusty and he doesn't always hear very well or understand things very well. He's very old, very hard of hearing. And his name happens to be Trumpkin. And he's an important enough character that you can't just leave out his name, you know, and just call him the prime minister. You can't do that. And, you know, given that we had someone, Trump, who was president at the time and who, you know, basically had a lot of characteristics that a lot of people do not and did not like, there's no way you could film that without being attacked both by the pro-Trump people and maybe even by the anti-Trump people. Who knows? So, you know, I knew when Trump was, you know, when Trump got in, that, you know, that was going to be it for the silver chair. You know, they couldn't do it. They couldn't do it. You know, remember that.
How far experience did they actually get? I mean, I don't think
they did. They did The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. They did Prince Caspian. The next one they were going to do, well, the horse and his, they were thinking doing the horse of his boy, but that was sort of knocked out because the main evil guys in that book are a civilization that is based to some extent on Southeastern Asia and ancient Persia. And they figured if they do this, there were enough details that could be associated with that part of the world that someone thought it could be taken for a caricature of the Near East, you know? So that was sort of out politically. And then the Trump.
Yeah, they only did two, right?
They did two. They had plans for the other, and then they were going great guns. They had treatments, they'd hired people, and everything was suddenly shelved, you know? But, you know, but Narnia, of course, had the advantage of being an admitted fantasy. Although Narnia always disappointed me because Narnia did not have its own language. Basically, everyone spoke English, and the gimmick was that it had been settled by English people. But there were some linguistic issues in there. I don't want to get into Narnia. You know, if we ever do a series about linguistics or an episode that's about linguistics and not about writing systems, I can go into the linguistic foul-ups, bleeps, bloops, and blunders of the whole Narnia series, which are amazing, but that has to be another story, you know?
Actually, I would love to do the language of Watership Down. Did you?
Yeah, we could definitely do that, which of course did not have a writing system because the people in that book were talking rabbits.
Yes.
You know, so they didn't write, you know, they had very interesting legends.
They did actually, you know, in that particular warren where they were kept by people, they started to have symbolic writing.
Well, they started to. That was the one where they were basically, where some of them were captured, were basically laboratory rabbits and they were imitating their captors. Now, I will tell you, Watership Down, I read it, I loved it. It was a huge book, but I have to say, used it as a doorstop at one point. But to get on to Psalmanazar, I will tell you that if there's any good response to this series, I will consider maybe doing future series in which I wear funny hats, possibly future episodes on constructed languages, After all, we have Klingon, we have Elvish, and we even have a guy who, there's a person I want to, would love to talk about maybe next time, who had a writing system and a language for language they made up, which he thought would save the world from illogic. And this was someone, you know, and a somewhat older contemporary and also English of Psalmanazar, who literally made up a language that he thought if you learned it, it would force you to be logical. And therefore, if he could get his, if he could get English to speak this language, they would conquer the world. Well, he didn't. So that didn't happen. But he had a writing system, and it was, it had the distinction of being a language that you could probably learn, but because, but that language, unlike our fellow here, he, the fellow I'd like to talk about next week, worked it out in detail, vocabulary, grammar, but worked it out in such detail that if you actually tried to speak the language, you would run into a very weird problem or two. But leaving that aside, Psalmanazar, unlike a lot of the language creators today, the people who create languages for movies like Game of Thrones or for series like Star Trek, where they have the Klingon language and the Vulcan language, or even earlier, Lord of the Rings, you know, when they create it for fictional purposes, which are avowed fiction, they normally do, a lot of them have the sense to make up everything, grammar rules, dictionaries, you know, even etymological guides, as well as writing systems. He probably didn't want to do that. He basically says in his book, he doesn't have room to really detail everything. So what he does is he shows the alphabet. He has some things like some prayers that he has translated into this alleged language. He gives what purports to be a historical background of the language, which purports to be historical linguistics, but is actually ridiculous. Let's go to that, baby. Now, Wikipedia on our mystery man. Here we, you will see the second, you know, the second of these is actually charted as purported Formosan alphabet. If you look at it, it's interesting because some of the letters have relationships to similar looking letters in the Roman alphabet or in the Hebrew alphabet, a couple of them, or letter, and sometimes he gives them similar sounding names, but you know, these are, I believe, creations of his fantasy. He was trying, I think, to make up something that would sound plausible to a fairly educated European who knew a couple of other languages, who, if he'd gone to college, might know some Greek, might know some Hebrew, might know some Latin. If you look at some of the letter names, some of them look vaguely as if they were meant to, you know, to spin off from Greek letter names or Hebrew or other languages that were exotic, but that were known of. One nice thing about it is that, unlike a lot of alphabet charts, he not only gives the name of the letter in transcription and the sound, but he actually transcribes the name of the letter in the language. And by the way, he does mention that, as you can see in this chart, it goes from right to left. He's got capital letters, but you can see they're on the right side because he does make up his mind that it goes right to left. Well, anyway, he gives his fake translation of the Lord's Prayer, which, you know, apparently to look at it, it looks as if he did have enough sense to just not transcribe, you know, the grammar of French or English, the languages we know he knew, into the group to be the grammar of this new language. He apparently is making up his own a grammar, you know, a plausible sounding grammar. You can tell by looking at it what certain words are, like, you know, what the word for heaven is and so on. And interestingly, he decides that there is a word for amen, but that it's going to be amien, which is interestingly French sounding, even though the French for amen is amen. But
so what kind of language was it?
He claims, that actually it's a variety of Japanese, as we'll get to, but which is total baloney.
That. What I'm asking is the grammar, like word order, morphology.
I would say it looks as if the verbs are sometimes at the end of the sentence. It doesn't look terribly convincing, but once you figure out that the word for heaven is apparently omeo, it looks like they capitalize all the nouns, but once we have the word for heaven is omeo, you see it in the first phrase, which our Father who art in heaven, in his made up language, that's ame, porneo, donchin, omeo, visi. Presumably, if visi is at the end of that phrase, that would be the word for are or is. So it looks like it might have the verb at the end. Well, he could have run into languages that have the verb at the end. In other words, he might have read, you know, there were already books about languages in countries other than Europe. He could have run into the, it doesn't look as if he's being too consistent, but then he doesn't have to be.
Is there a case, for instance?
He actually has something about that. He claims that there are case endings. He gives a few examples, and one of the links that I provided for the description is actually a link to his chapter on the Formosan language. It actually is very interesting. If you can get to that link and put it on the screen, I did not include it just because it's a lot of detail, and I frankly did not know. You know, how interested people would be, but he basically does give some case endings. He sort of makes sure in this passage that he's using them, but I would say that in terms of the phonology, it looks as if he's using only sounds that would happen to be familiar to a European who was reading his book. Even though he says, interestingly, that it's a tonal language, that
he actually does.
I probably should have copied it, but I was thinking that, you know, the wall of text, that just putting up a wall of text might make for very dull reading and that people could follow it.
If it has tone, how many tones does it have?
I think he says that they've got three, but I'm going to pull it up. I am actually going, because I have the link, and I'm going to pull it up. And what I will do is I will read you the interesting bits, and I will read you the interesting bits from his chapter on languages, and probably after every single sentence, I will say, this is totally fake. So just give me a moment because I've got my phone and I have the link on my phone. So I am going to call. And by the way, the name of his book is hysterical in itself, but I'll leave that. Let's see, I'm going down. The chapter in language is, by the way, chapter 27, which is at the end. And I'll read of the language of the Formosans. And I'm going to read this to you and I'm going to try to put on some snitty 18th century, slightly French accent. Okay, I considered faking a fake Asian accent, but since he didn't even try to look Asian, why would he have tried to sound Asian? The language of Formosa is the same with that of Japan. Totally fake if you look at this, and if you know, like, even one word of Japanese. But with the difference that the Japanese do not pronounce some letters gutturally as the Formosans do. So he's claiming that the Formosans have velar sounds that the Japanese don't. And they pronounce the auxiliary verbs without that elevation and depression of the voice, which is used in Formosa. Oh, yeah, and later on he does say more about the tonal system, but it's interesting they knew this could happen. That's why some people think that he might have heard bits of other countries. Thus, for instance, the Formosans pronounce the present tense without any elevation or falling of the voice as Jer Chato, Ego Amo. And it was conventional back then if you wrote books on languages to translate the language that you're analyzing into Latin rather than into English. So he claims that Jer Chato is Formosan for I love. And well, basically, I want to summarize the boring bits. So basically claims that the present tense is a level tone and that the past perfect is a rising tone. The future tense is a falling tone. But to create the past imperfect, they just add the auxiliary verb. And I'm going through these examples, basically doing different conjugations of, you know, a verb phrase of Jer Chato, which he says means I love. So in other words, the past imperfect would be Jer Viege Chato, but in the past perfect, it would be Jer Chato. And he actually describes how to raise your voice in which syllable. So the past perfect sounds just like the present, except it's a rising tone. And, you know, I wonder if he had heard a little bit about Chinese, being a tonal language, which was the tonal language that Europeans would most likely have heard a little bit of. And we know that some people were remarking that, you know, there were tones and that this was. So he gives these examples. Then he says the Japan language, which he's claiming is really also the foremost language, has three genders. Total fake. All sorts of animals are either of the masculine or feminine gender, and all inanimate creatures are of the neuter. Well, from what little I know of Japanese, I don't think that's true of Japanese. And he's saying that Formosan is a variety of Japanese, so that's okay. But the gender is only known by the articles, and he gives examples. He basically says that oi is an article that means this, a is an article that means that, and a is an article that means over there. Well, the cool thing is that it's true that Japanese has words that mean here and there and over there, but it's not true that they have articles. Today, we wouldn't classify them as articles anyway, but the words aren't the words he says they are. But in the plural number, all the three articles are alike. Again, total fake, because he's saying Formosan is a variety of Japanese, and Japanese does not do, you know, singular versus plural, right? They don't routinely do it. Oh, and then he says, he says that the Japanese have no cases, and they use the singular and plural number, but not the dual number. Well, no cases, check, singular and plural number, no. And then he says, so he gives some example, okay? He gives some examples, which I'm going to, he says something like, Oi Hanajo means this man in Japanese and in Formosan, which is not true, although it's the most Japanese sounding thing he's written so far. And then he says, Os Hanajos means these men, which is totally weird, you know? I mean, that's like, you made it look very European, Mr. P, you know? But then he sort of cops out. But since I do not intend to write a grammar of the language, but only to give some idea of it, it may be sufficient to add this general observation. And here he gets into that it, meaning his made up Formosan language, is very easy, sounds musically, and is very copious. If anyone shall ask from what language it is derived, I answer, I know of no other language except that of Japan that has any great affinity with it. But I find many words in it which seem to be derived from several other languages, only changing either the signification, in other words, the meaning, or the termination. In other words, he's claiming it's a variety of Japanese, and he's claiming it borrowed words. Okay, well, look, Japanese had borrowed words even back then. You know, if he's making up, you know, but most languages borrow words every so often. Then here he gets into the writing system, and he starts by comparing it by saying that the Japanese have switched to Formosan writing. Total fake. Here's what he says. The Japanese wrote formally in a sort of characters most like those of the Chinese is. Yes, he really says it. Well, okay, true, sort of true, okay. Very, even to this day, but not formally. But since they have held correspondence with the Formosans, they have generally made use of the Formosans' way of writing is more easy and more beautiful, inasmuch that there are few now in Japan who understand the Chinese characters. Well, this is like total bullpucky, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there might be fewer people now in Japan who understand Chinese characters, but still it would be most people.
They still do. I mean,
they still do. I mean, you hear about people not necessarily knowing some of the more complicated ones, but basically he's trying to say, like, Formosa is cool and awesome because the Japanese changed to write in Formosan script. Okay, and then he says, what? He says they use only 20 letters in that language, which are to be read from the right hand to the left, whose names and figures are as follows. And you see our third example, which I've copied there, is this chart. Okay, which actually, if you type in Psalmanazar Formosan alphabet on the net, it will come right up if you're too impatient to follow links. And then he says they have many particular rules as to the use of these letters, which would be endless as well as useless here to set down. In other words, they have lots and lots of spelling rules. And therefore, I shall only add the names of some things that are most common and subjoined to them, the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and Ten Commandments in that language to give the reader some idea of it. Well, he's a bit of a sloppy editor because he does give the Lord's Prayer. He does give the Apostles' Creed. He does not give the Ten Commandments. So here he's going to give a word list. You know, I'm not going to sit and read necessarily, you know, whole extracts of, you know, in a made-up language. But I'm going to give you... Okay, the emperor is called in that language Baghasan Cheveral, which is weird because it sounds like sort of almost like Sanskrit or something, i.e. the Most High Monarch. the king Bagalo or Ungon, the viceroy Bagalendro or Bagalender, the nobles Tanos. And he goes on, he gives words for things like governor, citizen, countrymen, soldiers, man, woman, son. You know, what's interesting is he says the word for son is bot and the word for daughter is boti. I'm wondering if he knew a little Hebrew because, of course, girl or daughter in Hebrew is bat. So I'm wondering, you know, I'm wondering about this. The rest of it, you know, I would say, however, it's likely he just basically made up what he thought would sound cool. Then he goes into what he thinks is his, what you might say is fake historical linguistics. The reason why the Japan language differs from that of the Chinese and Formosans is this, because the Japanese being banished from China settled in the Isles of Japan. I just hope any Japanese or Chinese person listening to this knows how we've been saying all along this is fake, okay? Upon which account they so much hate the Chinese that they have changed all things they have in common with them as to their language, religion, etc. Probably opposite of the fact, I mean, the Japanese really, really were and are into culture from China. I mean, so many Japanese words are borrowed from Chinese. This is just totally made up. So that there is no affinity between the Japan and Chinese language. Well, but the Japanese being the first inhabitants of Formosa, well, I don't think so. From what little I know about the history of Taiwan, not true, brought their language along with them into that island, which is now much more perfect than it was at their first coming. Yet the Formosans preserve still the purity of their language without any considerable alteration, whereas the Japanese are continually changing and improving it every day. So he thinks Formosan is linguistically conservative Japanese, only maybe better, more musical, etc. And then he goes into, you know, basically gives made-up language samples. And I've got some sources. Yeah, I've got some sources here. I want to tell you that all of these books, if you can find them, are very interesting. You'll find that, you know, in fact, I would say, look at them. He basically was a forger. But, you know, what happened to this fellow? His book was an unqualified success. You know, if you read and you are into interesting things, you read this book. It had two English editions and a French edition and a German edition, all of which are on the net, by the way.
Okay. And you say that he was a forger, but I mean,
I would say he's a forger, not so much a forger in terms of having faked anyone's signature, but he's forging an entire culture. In other words, he's basically writing something that he says is the writing of this culture. And he's, you know, a forger, a normal forger just puts, you know, fakes someone's name, writes something on a piece of paper and says, this is George Washington's signature on whatever. This person, maybe forged is not the right word, but, you know, he doesn't just make up one little line of writing. He's making up a whole language, well, at least enough chunks of it to write stuff in, to translate stuff into, a writing system. He's obviously spending some time on it because graphically it's very interesting. You know, the man had a sense for design. Let's give him that. It's a cool looking alphabet. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if someone, you know, took this and made it be the alphabet of some civilization in some science fiction movie. Anyway, but he was convincing enough that learned societies, in other words, groups of academics and intellectuals, invited him to do lectures on Formosan language and culture. And a proposal was even made. Oxford proposed that they call him to lecture at Oxford and actually even to start, you know, a chair of Formosa. In other words, in our terms, the Department of Formosan Studies. That's, you know, he actually, when he spoke before the Royal Society, he was challenged by Edmund Halley, a famous scientist in his own right, discoverer of Halley's Comet, a man who had many other achievements. But even though Halley was very, very famous and very respected and was known to be, you know, a very exact scientist, people didn't really want to listen to Halley because it was much cooler to hear George Psalmanazar, you know, lecture about the far-off island with the men walking around in the metal jockstraps and the human sacrifices and the glorious architecture. And, you know, and Halley said, you know, this doesn't look like what else we know. And, you know, and Psalmanazar would basically say, well, whom do you trust? You know, some Jesuit missionary who wrote something, you know, or an actual Formosan prince who came over here. Well, skeptics challenged him again and again, but he would deflect it. For instance, he explained, why is he so pale? You know, why is he as pale as a European? Because of being an upperclassman living underground. So Jesuits who talked and basically said, you know, this is baloney. We work there. This country is nothing like that. Everything is totally made up. They didn't believe because, you know, at that time, you would not believe a Jesuit. Now, enough people have written about this language and have taken an interest in it that they're actually, that it actually has been assigned codes by the people who study conlangs. In other words, in languages that are consciously invented for any purpose, it actually is listed there. Now, it's very interesting, you know, you might want to go on is, so how and why did he eventually give up? Well, let's go to what, if you go ahead from, but wait, there's more. That's basically bits I covered because he was talking about the language. So we can go on other than that. This is basically lies and fiction department incorporated. Now, okay, you can explore his fake travelogue. I put the links in there, but I should go into what, so why was he revealed? Well, Oxford was saying, we need you to go and teach, you know, the Department of Formosan Civilization because you want to, you know, raise money and train people to go and, you know, to go and, you know, reach these people because, you know, why would Europe not want to find some way to have connection with a very, very rich country, so rich it can afford to kill 180,000 babies a year? You know, it's so rich, he describes, you know, the women is, you know, wearing lots of jewels and that, you know, and that even, you know, the lower classes do very well. You know, this is basically what empires want. Find a rich country that isn't part of your culture and get them to be part of your culture. In other words, you know, why wouldn't they want this? So, you know, once they're thinking of training people to actually go, you know, why leave it to the Jesuits? Why shouldn't England, you know, go and sail out there and take it over? He realized the jig is up and he wrote another book. And basically this is the one where he fessed up, told what his real life was, didn't tell his name. He claimed because he didn't want to bring shame on his family. I suspect that he also was embarrassed. And what he did after that was, well, he became a celebrity again because he fooled everyone. And then he fessed up. So he was, you know, now doubly a celebrity, you know. If people loved him, they might not have loved finding out that he was a con man, but they loved him being a repentant con man, especially because, you know, he went actually, and he spent after starting to come clean, which he did apparently first by telling people and then eventually by writing an autobiography, which actually the autobiography came out when he died, you know, but he had apparently come clean before. He told people, I'm going to write my real life. And eventually he did this. Well, he decided, everything I wrote was fake. Oh, there was no underground beautiful. Apparently his book says somewhere that the houses were circular. So maybe they were more like hobbit holes. I don't know. Oh, by the way, what happened to the 18,000 young boys? If you want to know, they burned the hearts for the gods and the priests ate the bodies. That's why some people think he must have read something about the Aztecs. Mm-hmm. Oh, and also they seem to have been into cannibalism among his made-up Formosans. The punishment for infidelity on a woman's part is that your husband got to eat you. Yum. And they eat, but other than that, you know, they miss most of their staple food is snakes. Oh. Anyway, so okay. Of course, so this is going, so let's just say this is freaky. You know, someone should base a graphic novel. Well, eventually people started hearing more and more. Eventually they heard enough that even if it is what people you politically dislike, it adds up. Nothing about this actual country is fitting with what's in the book. He had been in a lot of business failures. you know, let's just say everything came together at a bad moment around the time that they were thinking of, you know, let us, you know, learn about Formosa and add it to the British Empire, you know. Well, he had failed to market decorated fans that he claimed to be from Formosa that he'd actually had made up, and they didn't sell. Don't ask me why fake Asian fans didn't sell then, but they did. And he'd had a few other failed business ventures for promotion items. And, you know, basically he'd been trying to sell them through his missionary friend, but that didn't work out because his missionary friend had gone to Portugal to be a chaplain general to the British forces, but on the way had developed an opium addiction. So, you know, when your business manager who's trying to sell, you know, your fake Asian fans, you know, becomes a dope head, you know, your business won't do so well. So in 1706, eventually, you know, he couldn't keep his businesses going. You know, the Formosan craze was sort of trying to burn out because, you know, people were starting to have more than one source of info. He was no longer the only source of info on this far-off land. So he confessed to his friends, then to the public. He apparently lectured and addressed people. And, you know, they're all, you know, for, you know, the Formosan thing was out of fashion. So what did he do then? He worked for a while as a clerk in an army regiment. He'd had contact with the army through his missionary friend in the army. Then some clergymen gave him money to study theology. And he then became what was known as a Grub Street pamphleteer. Grub Street being in the old days where the hack writers would live. He wrote little pamphlets, he edited books, copy editing, proofreading, just all the little scut work of the literary profession, much like many people, including yours truly. Okay, he did learn Hebrew, actually, which he might have learned a little before. Well, as a Sturgeon student for the clergy, would have wanted to learn Hebrew. He co-authored a book called by Samuel Palmer called The General History of Printing, which is a nice, rather authoritative book on the printing industry, and contributed a number of articles to an encyclopedia known as the Universal History. And apparently these were factual articles. He'd gotten into writing actual facts instead of making up made-up civilizations. He even contributed to a well-known reference work of the time called A Complete System of Geography, and apparently his stuff there was all genuine too. He wrote in that book about the real conditions in Formosa, actually criticizing the hoax he himself had perpetrated. In other words, he literally said people, you know, have been misled by this very famous work, and I was connected with this, and I have to tell you, sorry, this is not so. It never was so. And like many men as he grew older, and many women too, he did become increasingly religious as a Christian. He probably was worried, you know, he spent all these years lying to people, you know, like many people, you know, whether or not there is a heaven and afterlife, many people might not want to approach death having this on their conscience that they'd spent about half their lives fooling everyone. Besides, if he really was a Christian, really believed in a heaven, a life after death, he might have said to himself, you know, what's this going to be like if I go to heaven and up there, there are all these 8 zillion Taiwanese, you know, what's going to be up there? He might have thought that. And he actually published, although anonymously, a book of Protestant, you know, theological essays in 1753. So he was sort of a celebrity, not as big the second time around, but he was a celebrity for a while when he fessed up, but then he did lose money. But there were some very interesting coincidences in life. He was actually a friend with Samuel Johnson, the literary figure. When Samuel Johnson was a young man, Psalmanazar was a young man. Psalmanazar was old when Johnson was young, and Psalmanazar was well known around the neighborhood as an eccentric but saintly figure who was, whereof he was so well known and esteemed, Johnson says, that scarce any person, even children, passed him without showing signs of respect. And this is even though he became very decrepit and very close to being homeless in his old age. In other words, people, even the kids, respected him rather than, you know, laughing at the weird old guy in the rags throwing stones. He also tried to get into the literary world in a legitimate way. Early in 1741, he sent an unsolicited manuscript to a novelist called Samuel Richardson, of whom you may have heard. Samuel Richardson was very famous for writing a very sexy romance novel called Pamela, which have you ever read it?
I've heard of it, but I haven't.
It's actually a really fun novel because it's one of the first books to be written not as a narrative, but as a series of letters, literally letters from this woman, Pamela, you know, to and from other people talking about her life and how she ends up in her life, basically not too clean a life, shall we say. And it was very, you know, hot romance novel told in this interesting gimmick where you're reading letters like you're reading someone else's mail. You know, how cool is that? Well, he tried to write a sequel. So he wrote 40 handwritten pages and basically said, you know, I think this book should have a sequel. I'm writing the sequel. Are you okay with that? Would you publish it? And unfortunately, Samuel thought that the attempted sequel was ridiculous and improbable. We don't know what it was, but apparently it wasn't believable. Then in a modest proposal, if you're looking it up, if you're looking it up, Swift calls Psalmanazar and that the famous Psalmanazar, Psalmanazor, not certain how to spell it, a native of the island of Formosa, who came from thence to London above 20 years ago, and basically describes him as an eminent proponent of cannibalism. So if you're looking it up, he was famous at the period. Then one of Tobias Smollett's novels, and he was a very famous novelist back in the day, refers mockingly, although very accurately, to Psalmanazar, who after having drudged half a century in the literary mill in all the simplicity and abstinence of an Asiatic, subsists on the charity of a few booksellers just sufficient to keep it from the parish. In other words, to keep him from depending on the parish charity fund for keeping alive. And he did, however, later get in his old age an annual pension of £30 paid by an admirer. Well, that went a bit further than it would today. Figure today would be like about $500 a year. Not a lot, but you know, probably enough to keep you from absolutely starvation. And then in his later years, he wrote his memoirs of **, commonly known by the name of George Psalmanazar, a reputed native of Formosa. And that was published posthumously. It doesn't give his real name, which we don't know, but it has all this detail about his early life and basically what he went through in order to become a scamster. Now, my question is, I'm wondering if you or if any of our commenters, perhaps you have had commenters, could it happen today? Why or why not? What do you think, Aya?
Well, it would be a little bit harder to do that with regard to a human culture on this planet, because we just know too much. You know, we have Google Earth, and we have the World Wide Web. So I think if it were done, it would be done with other animals on this planet, such as apes or dolphins or whales. It's much more likely.
You mean like someone might pretend to have been raised by dolphins or something?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, actually, there are actually similar things I can think of that have happened, not concerning a whole culture, but as you know, in our own day, we have had people who have pretended to be brought up in a different culture or country than they actually were. As you recall, recently ahead of one of the African American organizations who had claimed basically to be of partly African American ancestry and to have been brought up in an African American. It turned out she hadn't been.
But here's the problem. Yeah. You know, this is really about genetics more than it is about culture.
Right. But she did claim that she had grown up in a part of the world where she hadn't. She did claim that she'd been part of a certain subculture, that she'd been part of, you know, of basically, you know, that her family had been, you know, African American, and that she'd gone to a church that was mostly from African Americans, and she made a lot of claims. There was another one who claimed to have grown up in South Africa, but in one of the parts where there are, you know, in one of the areas where there are, you know, where there was a certain, you know, group of Black people in South Africa. And it turned out she had, and it turned out she'd never even been anywhere in Africa. And you can, and of course, if, you know, I don't want to go into this, but if you Google literally people who pretended they were African or people who pretended they were African American. So, you know, we do have some of that.
Well, you know, but I mean, pretending to be African-American and pretending to be Bantu or something, that's completely different. You know, those are two different things.
It is. You're not making up a whole civilization. You're pretending to be part of a real one. I'd say it's about as fake. But
well, you know, I mean, it's not like you're pretending to be part of a real different civilization. It's an American subculture, and that's all it is.
But
all of us, you know, if it's like somebody in Lebanon pretending that they belong to a different group in Lebanon, you know, it's
right. That is a little different. Okay, although one of them did pretend to have been from the Caribbean, and she was someone living in the USA who'd never been in the Caribbean. And there were actually coworkers who were from the Caribbean who tried to expose her and said, you know, no, she's not from, you know, wherever it was, because, you know, I'm from there. And what she describes is totally not true. And apparently there were people who, you know, there were people who bought it. I mean, I would say that.
Here's what I'm trying to say. They usually make sure that they can fake it by just speaking usually English, you know, with a different accent.
Right, they basically assume an accent, vocabulary.
So it's a subculture, but it definitely nobody is going to pretend that they know Japanese when they don't know Japanese.
Right. Today would be too easy. However, you know, I wonder if it would be possible to pretend to have grown up in some subculture that no one ever had heard of, like a cult. You know, there are people who actually do escape from cults and write books about it.
Well, yeah, but you wouldn't pretend, for instance, to be Amish, because the Amish.
You wouldn't. There actually was one individual who did, and who was caught out eventually by other Amish people, actually. She was very notorious in Amish studies circles of her, and actually she still claims to be real, although she's been debunked. And her name is of all things Tora Bontrager. Okay, Bontrager is actually a well-known Amish name, but believe me, no Amish person names their little girl, you know, Tora, T-O-R-A-H. Anyway, if you Google Tora, T-O-R-A-H, Bontrager, I'm not sure it's pronounced B-O-N-T-R-A-G-E-R. Well, she has a site which basically has been debunked by actual ex-Amish people and actual Amish people who were shown printouts of her stuff from the internet. You know, as well, you know, I say printouts because, as you know, the Amish people, you know, they don't go on email. She claims to be ex-Amish, although still believing in some of it, but, you know, actual ex-Amish people and actual Amish people have been exposed in some way to her story have basically claimed no. And, you know, this is a very close-knit society. Apparently all the Bontragers know each other, and they know that no one had a little girl and did any weird blasphemous thing like naming her Torah. I mean, why is a good Christian Protestant Amish person going to name a little baby girl, you know, basically scripture, you know? That, I mean, by all accounts, by the way, Ms. Bontrager is a very arrogant woman. It is possible that this is not, it's possible and probable this is not her real name any more than George Psalmanazar was his. You know, it's very possible, say, people who know her and have estimated her character, that would be quite in character with her to give herself a name, you know, that basically means, you know, scripture, the word of God, you know? You know, she basically, let's say, thinks very, very highly of herself, but at one point she describes not only and not only being part of the Amish, but the specific Amish community she claimed to be born into. And it's a very small, very tight-knit group that's like so extreme that they're to the rest of the Amish, like the Amish are to the rest of us. And, you know, so someone was able to find them and like, no such person was born in that year or any other in this teeny tiny group. And, you know, and no such person, you know, got to any age and defected from the group because, you know, most of the Amish groups, you know, actually let you. They have a very good idea that when you get to be in your teens, they actually give you a choice to go into the outside world and basically decide whether to stay there or whether to come back after a year or two. And she claims, well, that's what I did. That's how I left this group. But unfortunately, the group she claimed to belong to was like the one group that doesn't do that. You know, you're born in the community, you stay there. They don't give you that choice. So if she was going to, you know, if she was going to claim to be Amish, she picked the wrong Amish to claim to be. So I would say that, unfortunately, you know, she got, the point is she got away with it, although for a little while. And again, basically once she, you know, once there was what amounted to informal background checking slash meet the real thing slash come on, I'm from her village and I never, ever, ever met her when she was supposedly going, you know.
Okay, but all of this is really just a
side issue.
A personal issue of
this is
saying I belong to this subculture rather than that subculture.
You're not making up a whole thing. You know, we couldn't get away with this, okay? Although, you know, there are people who claim to identify as all sorts of things, but I think we have not had, you know, I have known, for better or worse, I've known people who semi-seriously claimed to, you know, be elves or be descended from ancient druids or something. But again, they never got followers. They never got huge numbers of people following them. Interestingly, the closest we do have in this time that involved a large number of people was actually in a religious context also in the 20th century, and did get a lot of followers. And the person who was caught up on the bit that she faked, which was a very weird bit, not quite comparable to George P., but you'll see what it was. She was caught up to the point that she had to change her story, but didn't really fess up. You may have heard of a woman called Sylvia Browne, B-R-O-W-N-E, who passed away a few years ago. And she was a claimed psychic medium, and she had founded an odd New Age sort of church of which she was the head and the provider of the doctrine and the writer of the sacred, you know, scriptures. It was called Church of Novus Spiritus. Well, there were bits of the liturgy of her church that she claimed to be a prayer in Aramaic. And unfortunately, she printed this someplace. She claimed that Aramaic was the language of heaven, because it was language Jesus spoke, so they made it the language of heaven. Now, when I heard this claim, I actually wrote a letter to her and I said, well, Eastern or Western Aramaic, man, of what century? And she wrote back a letter which didn't really answer, but basically said, oh, you know, basically was a, you know, request for money, which, you know, so she obviously wasn't going to deal with that. Easier to send in a form letter. Well, the thing is, there are people in this world who know actual Aramaic, not only scholars, but there are varieties of our Aramaic, which are still spoken as languages in some parts of the world. And some people got on to her and basically wrote to her and said, whatever this is, this prayer that you claim to be an Aramaic prayer to this great mother goddess that you believe in, it's not Aramaic. I don't know what it is. So, you know, the next edition of her book that she came out with, she had changed her story. Instead of saying that the prayers that this prayer was in Aramaic, she said it was in the ancient language of Atlantis. Same prayer, but of course, pick on Atlantis because you can't prove anything, because if it ever existed, it fell under the ocean thousands of years ago and probably did, you know, and probably did not exist. Now, right now, if you Google Aramaic Sylvia Browne with an E, you will actually find people discussing this and taking it apart. In fact, I am actually Googling right now to find, at one point I actually had this in my notes because I thought it was just so ridiculous. I can't find it. Apparently she got very busy, taking down her old website, replacing it. So, she thought that she was sort of, let's claim that this is words in a language that nobody knows, because, most people think Aramaic is totally dead or they think nobody knows it. And then, real people. Okay, Sylvia Brown, actually, if you Google Sylvia Brown Aramaic prayer recap, if you do Google that phrase, and you'll come on the complete expose of this whole bit of Aramaic nonsense, one of many bits of nonsense from her, right, in my opinion, So I'm going to tell you, I'm going to read you her fake Aramaic. You know enough of a Semitic language to tell me what you think it's supposed to mean, and I'll tell you what it's supposed to mean, and you will just laugh. So the fake Aramaic prayer, now claimed by her surviving church to be a prayer from Atlantis, is Arem, Shem, Beth, Sedal, Sacrivalian Ahad. What do you think that's supposed to mean?
Well, it sounded like the name of Aram. And then there's something about Sigal, which is a flower. And the rest
Well, it's Sedal with a D, not Sigal. So,
Okay, sorry.
But anyway, don't worry, because you didn't get it, because there's no reason you couldn't, because it's made up. This allegedly means, blessed be this queen on high, who is sacred to all that come to her. And later editions of the book claim that one of the words was the word for amen, but come on, amen in Aramaic is amen. Anyway, people got onto her, including a guy who has, of all things, an Aramaic tattoo service where you can get things tattooed on you in Aramaic that he guarantees will be accurate. A lot of people, will do tattoos that basically are made up. And if you've ever seen some of the fake Chinese or fake Arabic or fake, Sumerian or fake Sanskrit tattoos that people, they come in and they say to the tattoo guy, oh, I want superpower tattooed on my chest in Sanskrit or something, or I want love tattooed on me in cuneiform or Chinese, or a lot of people will just make this up, or they copy something, but they don't copy it well enough to be legible. In fact, if you ever wanted to go into the business of making horribly fake, stupid tattoos, there is actually a book on Amazon for the aid of such tattooists called, of all things, the cuneiform alphabet, which shows like 26 different cuneiform symbols and says that one of them is A, one of them is B, one of them is C, total bullpucky. And there's another book you can get which purports to do the same for the Chinese alphabet. So wow. In a way, the spirit of George Psalmanazar has not died. It has just moved into the tattoo shops and weird cults of the world.
Yeah, but I don't think Oxford would buy it.
Oxford would not buy it. Individuals might. Oxford wouldn't buy it because they can check. However,
individuals could check if they wanted to as well.
But they don't.
They don't. We all have access to the World Wide Web, and we all could.
And even then, however, even then, people, even in the late 17th, early 18th century, had access to more info than they wanted to use. Anyone anywhere in Oxford University could have picked up one of the, travel guides by the Jesuits, and could have read their description of actual Taiwanese language, culture, writing, which was Chinese, the whole bit. They could, those books were there. Those books were sold,
I wonder what was known about the Austronesian people who were the natives of Formosa.
Not much. What the people whom the Jesuits typically wrote about were the more Chinese influenced people, because, when you are a missionary, one thing you might want to do is find out who's influential and convert them first, particularly if you have already been in China and they had a bit of a history in China. They had a lot of scholars of Chinese language and cultures among their ranks, including some who had actually passed the very strict Confucian, tests for being an accredited scholar, which is amazing if you know what those tests were like. In other words, if you already know Chinese. And you know that Taiwan at the time had, you know, it had native people, but the aristocracy, the guys who were running things were Chinese. You're going to want to talk to the Chinese first, because if you can convert them, maybe they'll just do your work for you and get the serfs to go along. And they did actually have, in China and in Japan, as you know, they did have, you know, make, have a little traction for a little bit, you know, even though in both countries, eventually, you know, they get, eventually they did not want to hear anything about, you know, any Western religion, you know, but they had enough traction that they were actually Christian groups for many years that had sort of gone underground and had had increasingly Asianized versions of Christianity, basically, you know, hiding out in the basement and hiding out in the middle of nowhere and trying to preserve what they remembered from when there had been Christians, you know, in their country. Yeah, I mean, not that I care one way or another, other than I am against people being persecuted over their religion, which is what was happening. But that's, but I would say that the Jesuits, from what I've read, from the few things I've read by them, they seem to have known, oh yeah, there are these peasants and they're sort of different, you know, but let's focus on the upperclassmen, upper class people, partly because the Jesuits, at least at the time, were mainly upper class people. And their idea, at least at the time, I don't know about now, I don't know that many Catholics, I know no Jesuits, you know, but their idea at the time was that if you appear to be a person of stature yourself, a person who is rich and, you know, and who has culture and who is, you know, really in charge of things, if you go there and you don't look like someone absolutely poor, if your poverty is dignified, if your robe is black, but if it can be a silk robe, for instance, if you're of that particular rank, you know, then you're more likely to get some Chinese nobleman or some Chinese Buddhist priest to at least listen to you than if you show up and you look like a peasant and you're interested in the peasants. You know, they, you know, there are different ways. If you're trying to influence people, it's probably a little different if you're dealing with a very structured, very hierarchical society versus one that's not so much. And I would say that probably any, probably as a con man, our fellow George Psalmanazar knew it. I mean, he didn't pretend to be just Joe Average guy from Formosa. He pretended to be from the top of the heap. Yeah. And I would assume, I would suspect that since his autobiography revealed that as a child, he'd been in Catholic school and he'd been in Franciscan school and then a Jesuit school, he would have had the opportunity to compare both approaches. The Franciscans, you know, are very, very into poverty and simplicity. The Jesuits, you know, they seem to enjoy themselves a bit more. He might have just, he might have thought, you know, if this is a kind of person, if a cleric is a kind of person who has some sway, you know, then if you want to have some sway, well, which kind do you want to look at? Like, you know, the guy who wears no shoes and he's got a brown robe and he is under a rule that forces him to, you know, be, you know, that, that forces him to have, you know, really no private possessions? Or do you want to have someone who has a little leeway and someone whose organization is being joined by, well, basically at the time, rich people? You know, whose strategy do you want to emulate if you want people to believe what you are saying? You know, so maybe I am a fool not to go and try to look like someone super rich and stuff. Maybe I am a bit of a fool, but I hope if so, that I'm an honest fool. Now, by the way, if anyone out there has any chat comments, I'd love to hear them. If anyone out there has, you know, wants to write anything in a, in the Formosan alphabet, I will say I didn't want to try. I was thinking of doing it, but I said, I can't bring myself to write something that I know to be a fake that was for the purpose of faking people, you know? Mm-hmm. I couldn't do it. In other words, if we do something on constructed languages and it's for any purpose other than the fake, if we want to, you know, we do a thing on how did Tolkien come to invent Elvish? How did Mark Okrand, who worked for Star Trek, come to invent Klingon? You know, if we want to do, I mean, I'd love to do an episode on, The other big 17th century made-up language, which had a serious purpose, even if we failed, that was a language created by an Anglican cleric known as Bishop Wilkins. And maybe we can do next episode. That was the language that was supposed to make you entirely logical. He called, and he created a writing system for it, too, a very complex, almost, it's phonetic, but it looks like ideographs. That one was called Bishop Wilkins' Real Character. In other words, this is the real way people should write, you know? And if you look it up, I'm going to give you a little tidbit on this, unless you can tell me, were there any chat participants today or not?
Well, we had chat, but it was not necessarily on point. So William was talking about donation fraud.
So yeah, basically that's what this is. Basically, this guy, George P., had a donation fraud going for decades, you know? So I say it was sort of on point, you know, more than some comments have been. And, you know, we do have to be alert for these. So I really am thankful for William's comment, because some people never change, even if the strategies change, even if what or how they fake might have to change to avoid getting caught out, you know? Mm-hmm. You know? I mean, there have been in our time people who did fakes by pretending to have communicated with UFOs and writing books about the so-called Martians or Venusians, and even in some cases, having pages of their language. We should get into that sometime, although I have no stomach for the fake. But anyway, if anyone wants to, I would very much like to do Bishop Wilkins' Real Character, because it was a cool language. I would say, even though I don't know it, I don't know of anyone who does know it, it would be extremely difficult to learn unless you were a computer. But one of the cool things was that he actually had one of the earliest ideas for a version of what later became the metric system. One of his ideas was that people should make inches and feet be decimal instead of related by 12s and threes and this. You know, that didn't catch on, but the people who came up with the metric system later in France, some of them appear to have read his other book, which was on the metric system. But just to give you an idea of the pitfalls of creating a language and being serious about it, if you think it's going to be some perfect language, the fellow we'll talk about next month, I would like you to tune in next month and find out about the Anglican cleric whose whole endeavor, if it had succeeded, would have been disabled a mere 100 years later by the biological existence of the whale. And if this makes no sense to you, it will make sense to you next month.
Okay, that sounds like a wonderful promise. I look forward to that. So thank you, Kate, for your presentation tonight.
Thank you.
Yeah, and next week, anybody who's interested in seeing me wrangling a snake,
yes,
to tune in. And the week after that, we are going to have an author. His name is Howard Andrew Jones. He's written a book called Lord of a Shattered Land.
Ooh.
And it's part of the Chronicles of Hanover. And Hanover is based loosely on Hannibal of Carthage.
I don't always tune into a lot of your broadcasts. I'm not always free at that time, and not always free to get back to them later. But, you know, I just might tune in. You know, anything based on Hannibal and Carthage sounds interesting. I'm not promising, but I might tune in, and I might be able to tune in next week when you wrestle that snake. I don't know if I will be free, but I saw someone wrestle an alligator once, a snake. I'd be interested to see what it looks like with a snake.
Okay.
Anyway, I hope that this was good. I hope that this was fun.
It was great.
Yeah. And if anyone out there wants to look up the fake Formosan alphabet and write hello or Psalmanazar or Kate or Aya in it or anything else, well, do it and send it to me. I just couldn't nerve myself to do it. And it was probably to make up for that I decided, well, this will be Funny Hat Week. I'm not guaranteeing a funny hat next week because they don't quite have the nerve to make a fake bishop's mitre and wear that. But I might do something. I might do something. I'm not promising. It depends on how much time I have. June is turning out to be pretty packed for me. Anyway, I've got to go now, but it's been very pleasant to have you along. And if you find anyone walking around wearing nothing but a metal jock strap, send them right over and I'll see where they come from.
Okay, that's a deal. Good night.
Good night.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Good.